life where it's so dry and dead. But that little bud of flower reminds us that God is the God of Easter, the God of resurrection. So if you could join me in spirit as I pray the pastoral prayer. Lord of dawn and darkness, how grateful we are for your loving mercies. You saw our fear and doubt, our suspicion, our mistrust, and you banished them from our lives, replacing them with hope, peace, love, and joy. You called us to be your witnesses to all the world, unafraid of what others might think or say about us. We have been invited out of our darkened hideaways into the light of your world as emissaries of hope and justice, peace and compassion. Be with us as we participate in ministries of healing and hope through this church, in our community, region, nation, and world. Give us courage and strength to be your disciples in all the circumstances of our lives. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I invite you to take this moment of prayer to write a card or to lift up your prayers that you have. And I will pray for you in this moment. But also take a moment, 1 minute, to just be silent with God right now and lift up your prayers. Loving and gracious God, we come before you today with thanksgiving in our hearts and praises to your name as we give thanks for your gift of resurrection and salvation. In the midst of our fears and doubts and anxiety, we find it hard to be faithful to your calling in our lives. Even though we want to be faithful witnesses of your good news, we often find ourselves timid and without words. We shy away before we have a chance to share with others how good you've been to us and give evidence of our hope in you. We ask that you bless us to be bold in our witness of your goodness. Remind us that we are children of God, born of water and the Spirit of the living God, so that we might boldly proclaim your salvation to the world around us. We also take this time to remember and pray for the world and others in our community. We ask for your healing for those who are sick, provision for those without food or shelter or means for life. Lord, we also pray for Christine Nguyen's dad to pass his written test and that he'll be able to drive. We also lift up prayers for Ethan and his family, that you continue to walk with them in this season of grief and be with them and guide them to see your goodness. We pray for Sandy and her mom and her brother for healing, Lord, for your healing hands to touch them and to guide them to find hope in you in the driest and darkest seasons of their life. We pray for Mr. M, who continue to battle, to struggle, to fight against his illness, Lord. We pray that you continue to be with him. Give him strength this day to know that he's not alone, God. That he's never alone because he has you. You continue to carry him and his family through this hard time. So may you continue to guide all of them, Lord. And Lord, we also remember ALC, our church members. We lift this church up to you, Lord, for this is your people, and you call us to be witnesses of your good news. So please be with us, Lord, and guide us. Help us to be your hands and feet in San Diego. Help us to continue to support and send out missionaries across the world so that your good news, God, might be felt, because the world needs your hope, your salvation, and your everlasting life. We thank you, God, and we lift all these prayers up to you, and we pray. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Also right now, let us say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and glory forever. Amen.
Good morning, ALC. If we could all rise for today's worship. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. When I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness, blessed be your name. Sing every blessing. 'Cause every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to pray. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be your name when the sun's shining down on me, when the world's all as it should be. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name on a road marked with suffering. Though there's pain in the offering, blessed be your name. 'Cause every blessing you pour out, I'll turn back to pray. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your glorious name. give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. You give and take away. You give and take away. My heart will choose to say, Lord, blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be your glorious name. Of who I am, but because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. 'Cause I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind, still you. Hear me when I'm calling, Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I'm yours. I'm yours. Who am I that the eyes that see my sin, but look on me with love and watch me rise again. Who am I that the voice that calms the sea will call out through the rain and calm the storm in me? Not because of who I am, but because of what you've done, not because of what I've done, but because of who you are. I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow, a wave tossed in the ocean, a vapor in the wind, still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling, and you told me who I am. I'm yours. I'm yours. I'm forever. am yours forever, Lord. I'm yours. I'm yours, I'm yours forever. I'm yours, I'm yours forever. I'm yours, I'm yours forever, Lord. I said, I'm yours. I'm yours, I'm yours forever. I'm yours, I'm yours forever. I'm yours, I'm yours forever, Lord. Cause I am a flower quickly fading, here today and gone tomorrow. A wave tossed in the ocean, vapor in the wind, still you hear me when I'm calling. Lord, you catch me when I'm falling. You told me who I am. I'm yours. I'm yours.
You have been so, so kind to me. sing it. Oh, the overwhelming.
Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God. Oh, it chases me down, fights till I'm found, leaves the 99. 'Cause I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
No shadow.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
There's no wall.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me.
Sing again.
There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. Oh, there's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me.
Last time. There's no wall.
There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. I'm found, leaves the 99. 'Cause I couldn't earn it, I don't deserve it. Still you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Let's pray. Father, we just give you this time of worship. We just proclaim your love, God, and all you do for us, Father. So just be present with us, God, and continue just to fill our lives with your wisdom and your glory, God. So we pray this all in your Son's name.
So before we go to our prayer confession, I just want to celebrate and rejoice with Christine and KJ for their effort at pickleball yesterday. They actually won gold. So give them a round of applause. So this should encourage you to come to our pickleball on Thursday. We have champions teaching us how to play pickleball. Okay. Let us pray the prayer of confession together. Please follow along on the screen and repeat it with me. Gracious God, you give to us your greatest gift, your Son Jesus Christ. As we still don't understand what is going on, you call us to be people of courage and hope, and yet we run and hide, doubting and fearing. You challenge us to proclaim our faith, but we huddle in darkness, whispering our words of discouragement. Shake us up, Lord. Forgive us when we seem to need prodding over and over again. Help us to see the presence of Jesus in our lives and remind us of all that he taught us, to help us to live as disciples, serving you by serving others. Change us, remold us, make us truly the disciples you have called us to be. Amen. Hear God's words of assurance. Do not be afraid. The light of God has vanquished the darkness. Christ is risen. Doubts are erased. Rejoice. God's love is poured upon you now and forever. Amen. The scripture for this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 24, verses 36 through 48. While they were still talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and frightened, thinking they saw a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you troubled, and why do doubts rise in your minds? Look at my hands and feet. It is I, myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones as you see I have." When he had said this, he showed them his hands and feet. And while they still did not believe it, because of joy and amazement, he asked them, "Do you have anything to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate it in their presence. He said to them, "This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything must be fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms." Then he opened their minds so that they could understand the scriptures. He told them, "This is what is written. The Messiah will suffer and rise from the dead on the third day. And repentance for the forgiveness of sins will be preached in his name to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things." The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Today's sermon's title is, "You Are Witnesses." Today is the third day of Easter, and as I mentioned last week, Eastertide is a period of 50 days, not just a single day, and it culminates with the celebration of Pentecost, a day on which the Holy Spirit descended upon the disciples when they were gathered together, enabling them to speak in tongues and proclaim the good news of God to the ends of the earth. Last week, we learned that Christ appeared to the disciples and Thomas through locked doors to offer proof of his resurrection. He came to them in their fear to offer peace and invited them to believe. Today's focus is different. It will not focus on the disciples or their disbelief, or on their beliefs, but on their call to become witnesses of the resurrection and the gospel. The scripture passage from Luke 24, verses 36 through 48 is another version of last week's passage in John 20. In Luke's passage, Jesus also appears to his disciples after the resurrection. But the difference is that today's reading does not say that the disciples are hiding behind locked doors for fear of Jewish religious leaders. And there's no stories of doubting Thomas. But while the disciples talk about the incident of Jesus appearing to the two disciples on the way to Emmaus from Jerusalem, the risen Christ comes and stands among them and says, "Peace be with you." After he says this, they are frightened, thinking that they saw a ghost. To prove to them that he's not a ghost, Christ gives them his hands and feet to look at. He even lets them touch him to prove that he's fully alive. They are still in disbelief because of joy and amazement. Then Jesus continues to offer tangible evidence of his resurrection by asking them, "Do you have anything to eat?" They give him a piece of broiled fish, and he takes it from them and eats it in their presence. Once Christ presents evidence that he is alive, he reminds them that of what he has spoken to them, of his prophecy, and he opens up scriptures and the message of the gospel to them. Then he appoints them as witnesses of the good news. From this scripture, I propose that we are called to witness Christ's resurrection and good news to the world. But we should do so in a way that invites others to walk along with us to witness the good news in our lives through our story and testimony. Today's scripture passage makes more sense when we read it in conjunction with the section right before it, which is the road to Emmaus. In that section, after the woman came to the tomb and saw that it was empty, they went to the 11 disciples and reported that they saw the empty tomb and that two angels told them that Christ had risen. Peter then ran to the tomb, and when he was there, he saw the strips of linen lying there and wondered what had happened. Just then, Luke transitions his story to the story of two other disciples, one named Cleopas, whom we have never heard before, only in this reading, but who was also a disciple of Jesus, and another disciple whose name was not mentioned. They were walking along a 7-mile journey from Jerusalem to Emmaus and discussing what had happened. On the way, Christ came and walked alongside them, but they didn't recognize him. He asked them, "What are you talking about?" And they were downcast. Cleopas asked him, "Are you only one visiting Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened there in these days?" "What things?" Jesus asked. They told him about Jesus of Nazareth and how he was a prophet, powerful in word and deed. But the chief priests and the leaders of the people handed him over to be sentenced to death by crucifixion. They said that it had been 3 days, and the woman told them that they had come to the tomb and it was empty. And they had seen visions of angels who claimed that he was alive. And even the disciples came to the tomb and also said that it was empty. Then Christ Jesus began to explain to them the scriptures and the prophecies about his death and resurrection. As they approached the village of Emmaus, Christ continued on as if he were going further. But they urged him, "Stay with us, since it's already almost evening." So he went and stayed with them. And when they were there, eating together, breaking bread, Christ took the bread, gave thanks, and broke it and gave it to them. That sounds like the Holy Communion, right? And once he did that, their hearts were open and the eyes were open. They recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They then remembered that their hearts were feeling warm on the way when Christ opened up scriptures to them. These two disciples immediately went to Jerusalem and told the disciples that they had seen the risen Lord and confirmed that he is alive. The two disciples in this story are grieving. They are sad because their master is gone. But instead of trying to make everything better and saying, "Here I am, I'm your Lord, I'm alive," he walks along with them alongside a road. He spends time with them in their grief. He gives evidence of his story, piece by piece, scripture by scripture. He even breaks bread with them. As a result, they realize that Christ walks with them and opens their eyes to see Him. Sometimes we rush to tell others about Christ. We don't spend enough time with them to let them experience the goodness of God in our lives. By walking with them, telling them our stories, and letting them see the work of God in our lives, they will see tangible evidence of God's goodness and open up to the good news we have to share. People are more interested in evidence than words. If they see the fruits of your life and how good God's presence is, they will want to have that goodness for themselves. And don't try to sugarcoat it either. Let them hear the raw experience of what led you to where you are in your walk of faith. Show them what God did in your life and how God turned your trials into testimonies, or how you found courage, resilience, hope, and faith through your struggles. That's the authentic experience of deliverance that will draw people to Christ. Suddenly, your story becomes your testimony. In the current passage, Jesus comes in their midst while the two disciples from Emmaus are talking with the 11 and those with them about their encounter with Christ on the road. He comes to them, offers them peace, and lets them see evidence of His resurrection. And once they see the evidence for themselves, they become receptive to the scriptures that He shares. He witnesses to them the good news and invites them to do the same for others. Today's story, as well as the story of Emmaus, Jesus is present with the disciples in their suffering and walking with them through their pain. And after He had done so, He presents His story of resurrection to give them hope and call them to be witnesses to that hope. Similarly, our presence with others opened them up to want to hear what we have to say, because without the former, the latter would not happen. While serving as a hospital chaplain intern at the VA, I visited a patient who left a mark on my heart. It was the first time I went to a patient's room, and it was nerve-wracking. I visited Mr. Colin, that's his pseudonym, a 68-year-old veteran, Navy veteran, who had COPD along with other lung diseases that made it hard for him to breathe. I told him that I was an intern chaplain and that he was my first patient. But he was so nice. He flashed the biggest smile and said, "It's okay." I got to know him a bit better that day. I found out that his wife lived in Mexico and she couldn't come to visit him. He was staying all by himself in the hospital. He shared with me that he met his wife while he went dancing and he fell in love with her eyes. During my second encounter with him, I saw him on a different floor. When I came to his bedside, he had his TV on, and on the table near his bed were cups and straws, and next to his bed was an oxygen tank, and on the top of his bed was a label saying, DNR, do not resuscitate. He was looking at his phone as if expecting a call from someone. And shortly after I greeted him, his wife called him. And I gave them some space and they talked for a little bit. And once they're done, I came back and continued our conversation. He told me that the doctors will be moving him to hospice soon. So I asked him, "Is there anything that concerns you at this moment?" He told me, "I don't want to be like a vegetable there are still many things yet to be done. I want to show my wife around, taking her to the ocean and taking her to Disneyland. From our conversation, I learned that he had to learn to speak Spanish to his wife because he loved her. Mr. Collins lived a hard life. He was in the Navy from 1970 through 1974. He used to drive trucks for a living. And earlier, in his first marriage, he lost his son after 6 weeks. When I asked him about his past and what made him happy, he shared that memories of his wife and the things he did with her and other things that he did for fun with her gives him joy. Once we got to know each other a bit better, and after finding out that he was a Baptist, I shared with him that God is always with us, both during our good times and our bad times. And Mr. Collins responds, "Well, he is our Father." I said, "Yes. Yes, he is. That God puts us here for a reason. God wants us to experience life in God's beautiful creation. God is there with us in every experience, whether good or bad." So I wanted to help him to create a framework for meaning making so that he wouldn't be downcast, since that was my job as a chaplain, to uplift his spirit. Our conversation continued for a while, and by the end, I asked him if he wanted me to pray for him, and he said yes. Holding his hands, we prayed together. I asked him if I could visit him again, and he said yes. After that time, I met him a couple more times, and our bond grew even stronger. A few days before I finished my internship at the VA, I learned from one of my cohorts that Mr. Collins had passed away. I was devastated and my heart sank. I wish I could have seen him one more time to say goodbye to my dear friend. Our relationship with others is very important because it reflects our relationship with God. God loves people so much that God sent Jesus to die to save us. God's plan for salvation culminates in the resurrection of Christ Jesus from the dead, and we are called to be witnesses to Christ's resurrection and good news. We witness Christ to them not because we gain something, but because our testimony offers people a chance to hear the good news of God so that they can have a life that is changed, so that they can have a relationship with God, and so that they can have eternal life in Christ. But before we can get to the confession and receiving Jesus into their heart part, they need to witness Christ's resurrection in our lives first. Do we sow signs of Christ's resurrection and exemplify Christ's love in our lives? Do we show others how much we love them and care for them? It is through these things that people desire the goodness that we have that comes from Christ's resurrection for themselves, whether that is hope, the hope that we have, or the fruit that we bear. By sitting with others in their pain, we are present with them and offering them God's grace and peace. This was Christ's gift for his disciples. He offered them his presence, peace, and peace after he came back to life. He came to them in their grief, in the fear, doubt, and confusion, and offered them his companionship on the road to Emmaus and his presence with them in the house. By providing them the proof and gift of his resurrection, he invited them to be witnesses. So before the heartwarming experience, there is a broken heart. Before the resurrection, there is the cross. Christ comes to us and his disciples during the hard times to offer them companionship before he offers them hope, the hope of salvation. We must learn to do the same when we witness the good news to others. Christ showed them evidence of his resurrection and physical presence to help them believe. He even eats a broiled fish to prove it to them. Christ isn't hungry, but it is for their good that he eats the fish. May we offer the same gift of companionship, of presence and grace to others, so that they might see the evidence of God's resurrection and come to Christ for healing and salvation. Amen. Now, as we continue to worship God through the call in the offering, I ask you to contemplate these words of where Christ is calling you today, of what evidence of God's resurrection is present in your life, and ask God to use that to witness the good news to others. Let your life be a living testimony, and also see how you can participate with us at AOC through your gifts, your presence, and your graces. Us so much, God, that you sent Jesus, your Son, to come to our world to save us, to give us hope, and to teach us your way of salvation. You gave up your life for us, Lord, so that we can have life. Even though we are undeserving, we have no merits for such goodness in our lives, Lord. Yet because of your great love, you didn't withhold anything from us, but you gave everything, including your life. Oh God, help us to remember this as we walk and live our lives. Help us to be reminded of your great love and the reason and purpose for our lives. Help us to share your good news to our neighbors, to our friends, our family, to the world around us. Help us to share our story of deliverance, of how you have delivered us, Lord. Because surely you've always been there with us, through thick and thin, through up and down. You were always there, and you continue to be there with us, right here and right now. So we lift up this time to you as we sing praises to your name, and as we give thanks to you, Lord. We also offer our lives and our offerings to proclaim your good news. We pray and ask that you continue to lead more and more people to come to you, to have that personal relationship with you, so that their lives can be changed, so that they can find hope, especially when they are without hope, when the world around them, around us, is hurting. Help all of us, God, to continue to reflect on your gift of life as we continue to live our lives together. Help us to be your peaceful presence and your grace to the world. And help us to remember your cross as we continue to bear our cross every day. We lift all these things up to you and we pray in Jesus' name, amen. And now we have announcements.
Good morning, ALC. We have a few announcements. Oh, sorry, I can't see it on the screen here. Okay, I'll have to turn around. So we are continuing with our house church. I'm going to look this way. We met just this past Friday in person, and it was a really great meeting. We gathered to share in a meal and had a great discussion about the idea of resurrection and heaven, and so it was just a really great time of fellowship. Please join us. That is Friday. This upcoming Friday we'll be meeting via Zoom, and then following Friday we'll be in person again. So please join us if you can. And as many of you know, we are planning a missions trip. So this is a visioning missions trip to see Pastor Tara and Pastor Jonathan in Vietnam. We are still open to having people come with us. The trip will take place May 26th through June 2nd. And that's just for Vietnam. And a few of us are going over to visit some of the other countries. Going to go see my daughter in Japan. If you're interested, the trip is still open. Please contact me if there's any interest. And Pastor Tara, for this visioning trip, requested that we, if we can, bring some children's book with us. So she's starting a summer camp to teach English, and I think that's on the next slide. But if you have any old, well-used children's book, if you want to donate or if you'd like to purchase a couple new books for us to bring to Pastor Tara, that'd be great. We are accepting the donations until May 19th. So this is the English camp that I was just speaking about. So this is aside from our visioning trip, and this is happening June 24th through July 19th. And I believe she has a few sessions. So if anyone is interested, this year Janet and I are just going on the visioning trip, and I believe this English camp is going to be ongoing. So next year we're going to try to go to this English camp. If you are interested, please contact Pastor Tara. And the cost, it's not cheap, but if this is something in your heart that you want to serve, please contact them, and I'm sure they'd love to have some help for this English camp. And of course, we have just our weekly events. We still have our Wednesday night prayer that's ongoing. We have the Bible reading. I believe Janet finished a session, and she will be continuing on with that. And again, Pastor Derek is always available for anybody who'd like to meet and, you know, speak with him for any issues, for prayers. And again, we have pickleball on Thursdays. And as Pastor Derek mentioned, you'll be trained by gold medal winners. So please join us if you have any interest in learning. And it's such a fun time to just, you know, share in our faith, not just in worship, but just in play as well. So please come out if you can on Thursdays. And we're continuing our prayer for Sandy and her mom, of course, and her brother, Mike. Again, the war in Ukraine, Israel, Gaza, they're just not a time of peace. I think in our world there's always some war going on, so just please be in continued prayer for that, the people there, and also for Mbok. I understand she's making good recovery and exercising, getting stronger, but continue to pray for her, and also for Mr. M and his family, as they're really going through this time of struggle for Mr. M. So please be in prayer for them. Okay. And of course, our Sunday worship times, it's 11 next Sunday, and then the first Sunday will be at 9:30 with sharing in a communion.
Receive the benediction. May the presence of the resurrected Christ be with all of you and lead you as you continue to live your life as a living testimony, to witness to God's love and God's grace in other people's life and bring them closer to God. Amen. We shout out.